So hi everyone, welcome back to the virtual Azure Community Day. For those who don't know me, my name is Sjoukje Zaal and I will be your host for the upcoming sessions. Next is Barbara Forbes. Barbara is a Microsoft Azure MVP, MCT and consultant, and she works in her daily life with Azure, Office 365 and Windows Server. Hi Barbara. Great to have you.
Hi, Sjoukje.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you. And you?
I'm fine as well. So you focus on Azure, Office 365 and Windows Server. Can you tell a bit more about that?
Well, in my daily job, the most focus is on the Azure part at this point and automating Azure and automating all things non-Azure. So I work a lot with PowerShell, for instance, infrastructure as code, stuff like that. I get to work with that daily.
Okay, nice. And that's also what your session is about?
Yeah, that's a nice coincidence. Yeah, my session is also about Azure automation and how you can get started on your journey.
Okay, nice. Then the floor is yours. Good luck with your session.
Thank you. So, as I said, this is Azure Automation, make the portal work for you. In this session, we're gonna work on how to automate Azure. So let's say you're already a bit familiar with Azure, you know your way around the portal, you've created your own virtual machines, you have taken a look at the platform as a service offers that are available. And it's time to start automating things because the portal is nice, but it's not that quick. And in this session, we're going to focus on that and see how you can get started with these things. First, let me introduce myself. My name is Barbara Forbes, and I'm an IT consultant. I work at SCCT in the Netherlands. I am an MCT and an Azure MVP. I write a blog about Azure and automation. It's at forbeswithafour.nl, and BA4BES is my Twitter handle as well as my GitHub handle. So a little agenda for today. These are the tools that we're going to talk about. The most basic tools, PowerShell, Azure CLI, the Cloud Shell, and after that, we'll get into ARM templates. For all these tools, I'm just going to show you how you can get started, show you a bit of tips and tricks, what resources are available, and of course, how the portal can be used for it. There's going to be a lot of demos because I like to just show you how you can do it. But first, I want to go into a little bit of theory. And that is to consider, firstly, that everything that we're doing here can be considered infrastructure as code or even part infrastructure as code. So with infrastructure as code, we are managing the infra of our resources with code, so without clicking. Managing could be creating them. Often you're creating them, but you can also update them or remove them or stuff like that. And by using these tools, you can get your journey started with infrastructure as code. I firmly believe that it takes a very long time to have a complete infrastructure as code environment. So what I always believe in is just start with bits and pieces. Start with infrastructure as code. Use the portal to find out what you're actually doing. And you will get your way and find your way like that. So don't think that you have to handle everything with infrastructure as code from the moment you get started, because I don't think you will ever get started. One thing that's important to consider with infrastructure as code is the difference between imperative and declarative code, where imperative describes how you get to your end goal. So if you want to deploy something, for example, then the imperative code would describe all the steps to reach that goal. Where declarative infrastructure as code will describe that end goal and how it gets there, that's what the code will solve for you. But you just declare where you want to be in the end. And we will see both kinds today. Another thing I want to mention before we start is the categories which Azure uses. And the reason for this is that they come back with every bit of infrastructure as code that we're going to talk about this day. So it plays a role in all of these, and it also plays a role in the portal. So that's the first bit where I will show that, which is here. If you go to the Azure portal and you go to all services, just bring that up. Here you see the categories that Azure has. And compute is something you will often work with at first because virtual machines are in there. But for instance, function apps are in there, disks are in there. Well, on the left, you can move to networking and you can find virtual network, but also load balancers and virtual network gateways. And this can also tell you how many resources are actually available within Azure. There's really a lot of resources, a storage resource, things like this. These categories, you're going to see them in one way or another in every piece of tooling that we're going to use today. And it's not completely consistent. They're not all the same everywhere, but and it doesn't mean that you need to memorize all of this, so don't worry about that. But it is good to keep track of that structure that is available instead of just having 200 different resources that you need to work with. There is some structure available there. So the first thing we're going to start with is the tool PowerShell. I describe PowerShell as a handy tool, but mostly a necessary tool within Azure, because there are a lot of options that you cannot do in the portal. And it is a bit of cheating because you could say you could do it with other code instead of PowerShell, but often PowerShell is one of the first options if you read the documentation. And if you have been working with Windows servers in the past, then you have probably seen PowerShell and are probably familiar with it. It's a very handy tool in the sense that it's pretty intuitive. It describes what you're going to do. Every PowerShell commandlet consists of a verb, which tells you what action you're going to take, and a noun, which tells you where you're going to take that action to. To manage Azure, you get to use the AZ module. There is also the Azure RM module, but this is really a legacy module. There's no development going on there. And I do believe there is nothing left that is possible in the Azure RM module that is not possible in the AZ module. So do get started in the AZ module if that's possible for you. It's an open source project, so you can view it on GitHub. You can put your issues in there and see what code is actually happening. And this enables you to manage everything in PowerShell from your local computer. To do that, the first thing you need to do is make a connection with PowerShell, and you can do with Azure, and you can do this interactively. And this is the only part where I made a little video because there are so many email addresses in that video that I needed to blur something. And what you will see if you watch that video is that you have the commandlet connect Azure account. And if you just use it like that, it will give you a code and you can go to the website that it shows and enter that code in there. So I just copy and paste this code, and this is the browser. And then it will use the logon that I already have from Azure. So here I can click which account I want to use. As you saw, I was logged in with multiple accounts. And this means I get that interactive logon from Azure, which also means that I can make use of multi-factor authentication or conditional access or other security measures. And that's how you create the connection. Now, this is fun, but let's see how this actually works. I have run one commandlet to start with because it takes some time to load. And that is an overview of all the AZ modules that will be installed. If you only install, use the commandlet install AZ, or install module AZ, sorry. I'm not sure if it's going to do all of them because I work a lot with Azure, of course, so I have installed some manually, but pretty much all of these modules are installed if you install the AZ module. And these are those categories that I was talking about. You see compute over here, we saw that in the portal. Let's see if network is there. Network is here, we saw it in the portal. We see functions, for example, and all these different Azure resources all have their own category. Now, when you're working with Azure PowerShell, you're not going to notice this because you load the complete AZ module. So you load all these submodules which are in there. But this also gives you some kind of recognition of how many teams are actually working probably on all these commandlets. And because they're all separate, for instance, as you can see, I have a preview here. You are able to use preview modules if you would want to. And the bottom, I'm not going to show more of that, but I do want to mention you see the Azure AD module. This is a separate module. So everything in the AZ module is really about resource management in Azure. So how would that work? Let's say I want to get an overview of all the resource groups that I have in my subscription. With PowerShell, the first verb I would think of is the verb get, because I'm not going to do anything, I'm not going to change anything, I just want to get information, literally get the information. And then a stripe, a dash, and everything starts with AZ, and I would start writing AZ resource groups, because mostly it works like that. The first thing I get with tab complete is AZ resource. Let's add a G over there and move on. And there we have AZ resource group. And this one does not need any parameters. I now just get an overview of all the resource groups in my account. So this is pretty neat and a pretty short code that I need to use for that. Now let's see if we can create one of those resource groups. And for create, I'm going to use new, because that's the PowerShell syntax for create, and a dash again, and I should be able to use on I tapped complete too soon, new AZ resource group again. So you see the nouns are often the same, and you can do different verbs to them. So let's do a dash again, and if I'm not sure about the parameters, I can just put a dash in there and press tab. And it will give me the first parameter that it needs, which is the name of the resource group. We call this resource group example. And if I dash again and press tab complete again, it's going to show me the location. So, and I should be able to even autocomplete the location. And it is thinking about it. Well, it did do it, but it did the wrong one. Let's see if I can be patient enough. No, I wrecked it. Well, it was fun. It is able to auto-complete West Europe, but it's not doing it now. You can put them together or separately. And if I enter that, I have now created that resource group. That's how quick it can go. So that's pretty nice. We now have a resource group. And if you're thinking to yourself, well, how do I know what parameters I need and what are necessary? You can always click through that resource in the portal because it's often the same parameters, the same names for them. Not always, but that can help you if you're thinking about what parameters should I use. Of course, you can also use documentation, but I like to be in the terminal and just click around and see what I get. Of course, never in production. I need to mention that. Don't play around too much in production. Do this in a dev environment. And let's say now I want to create a storage account. And I'm going to give a spoiler. We're going to create a lot of storage accounts today. Two reasons for that. One, they don't need a lot of parameters, so it's relatively simple. And two, they deploy very fast, so we do not need to wait too long for that storage account to deploy. So I'll start with new again, because we saw that work last time. And I should be able to say AZ store, and I'm going to tap complete from here. And the first thing I get is the storage account, which makes sense because it goes alphabetically. So now I have a new AZ storage account. Now I could use get help if I want to get some quick answers here. So if I enter get help before that new AZ storage account, it will tell me all the parameters that are in this storage account and that are available to you. And it is able to give me some examples. So everything is available that way. It's pretty nice. But I wanted to go the same way that I did before. I have a storage account. I'm going to push a dash in there and let it tell me what parameters it needs. So the first one is the resource group name, which we just created. It was an example. And let's see at the second dash. Well, this makes sense. It wants the name of the storage account. Now, for a storage account, there's one downside to a storage account, and that is that the name needs to be globally unique, and it can only have numbers and lowercase letters, so you're pretty limited. So I'm guessing this would be a great name, something to remember, of course. And let's put that dash again, and it now asks me for a SKU name. And I can already see in this information up here, here is that SKU name, and here it says that I have to choose between some different options. But what I can do here is use tab again, and it will go through those options for me. So I can go through all the options that it will accept, which is pretty nice. I'm going to take this one because it's the cheapest. And dash again, and it's going to ask for the location again. Let's see if it does now. Yep. There we go. Location, West Europe. Now, I could do a lot of extra dashes here. A lot of them are available. But I know I don't need to. So I'm just going to click it like that. Now, if you're wondering how, I mean, I have deployed a lot of storage accounts, so I know which parameters are necessary to create it. If you're not sure and you don't feel like looking it up, just enter new AZ storage account or whatever you want to do, and it will ask you for every mandatory parameter. All right, so it says that it has deployed that storage account now. And let's see if we can find it here. So I moved to my resource groups. And I move to example, which I just created. And the fun thing is you can actually be too quick for the portal. And I'm getting better at it. So either I'm getting faster or the portal is getting slower. And there we go. Here is that storage account that we just created. So with that basic information, you can really create anything you can think of with that with PowerShell. This is imperative, so you describe the journey that you want to take. And for PowerShell, I want to show a quick example of how far you can take this. For example, this is the code to create a virtual machine with everything that it needs. So a virtual machine, a resource group, it needs a subnet for a virtual network, needs a public IP address, a network interface, and this is deployed at the end. This is also one of the places where I think that the portal can help you out, because if you see this, this can get a bit abstract. And now this is just one virtual machine, but what if you have like 5 virtual machines and 3 different subnets all caught up in this code. You might get confused on what you're doing, and it can help really to check your work in the portal to see what is actually happening. And if I look at what we just, what that script created, these are the resources, and the screen is getting a bit messed up because of the high resolution. So here I can see all the resources, and here's a quick little tip. If you want to see the structure, you can, in if there's a virtual network involved, and you go all the way down and you see here diagram. And here I can get an overview of everything that is connected to that virtual network. Now, this is pretty boring because it's one virtual machine. But if you have a lot of virtual machines and a lot of subnets, this can come in handy to remember for yourself what was I actually doing? So that was the PowerShell part and how you can get started with there. And after that, I want to go to a different option that is available, and that is the AZ CLI. This is based on Bash, and this will probably be preferred by people who have a Linux background and are more used to that. By the way, all these things we talk about, you can use them all together. You can switch at any time you want. I'm not sure if it will make you happy, but it is an option. And the Azure CLI can be downloaded and then used in the terminal. So I can use it here in my PowerShell terminal, where I have downloaded AZ already. And if I click AZ, it will show it. But I can also use it in the command line if I want. Both these tools are, by the way, also available on Linux and Mac. So that's pretty neat, all those options that you have. And here we can see we have the AZ module, the AZ CLI. And here I see some categories again. Now, these are not the same as the categories that you saw on Azure. They're a bit different, but they really can help you out with finding out what commandlet you need to use, which command you need to use. And for example, let's say I want to list those resource groups again. My first instinct would be to go to resource groups. And if I do that, I will see it's not there. So that's a bugger. But the second thing I can think of is just group, because resources here, let's just call it group. And I can see I have group here available. And what you can do with AZ CLI is set AZ and then group, because we saw that as a category. And then you put dash H or dash dash help behind it. Now, when I do that, it will show me all the options that I have to move on from this resource. Within groups, I can go to the subgroup lock, which I do not intend at this point, or I have the option to interact with it, to have commands with it. So create, list, show, update. It's a lot like those verbs we just talked about, except they use different names because otherwise it would be too easy. So let's say I want to use AZ group and list all the resource groups because I want to see those resource groups that are available. And I press enter on that. And it shows me all those resource groups now in a JSON format, where the last resource, with PowerShell, it made PowerShell objects for you. This one makes JSON objects. So I just created that command. Now, let's say I wanted to create a resource group like we just did. I'd start with AZ and group again. And let's just put that H in between there just to see what those options are. And we see here the first option we have is create. So we put AZ group create. Oh, I thought I had autocomplete. You get really used to that. And let's put that H again, because I have no idea what this commandlet is expecting of me. And here I get a quick overview of the arguments that I can enter. So a location name, managed by, and tags. And it even tells me which are required. But it does something that I like even more, and that is it creates an example. It shows me an example. So I can work from that example to see what I want to create. So let's say create, and then it says L for location. And I'm going to use West Europe. And then N for the name of the resource group. Well, we were at example 2. And with this, I am able to create the resource group. So I get a JSON output now telling me the resource group has been created. Provisioning state says succeeded. So now how would that go if I want to create that storage account like we did before? Let's just see what options were available, what we were talking about. And here I see directly in my screen storage as an option. So let's see what options are available there. Switch the age there again. And here I need to create and use subgroups. So I need to add something to it. And the one at the top is immediately accounts. It's pretty handy to use an example resource that's alphabetically right at the top. So I would use AZ, storage, and then account. And let's put that H there again, because I want to know, do I need another subgroup or can I start creating from here? And there are some subgroups available, but the commands are also available. And I see a pretty cool command here, which is check name. As I said, a storage account has some pretty strict naming rules and it needs to be unique globally. So let's see how that works. Can't autocomplete. And let's put that H there again, just to check what it's expecting from me. And here it says it just needs a name. So I'll put the name in there and another beautiful name. And it says here that name is available. I would say this talk would be so much funnier if it said it wasn't available, but all right, it is available, so we have something to work with. So we have now checked that name. And if I look back over here, I could start creating that storage account. So let's see how that goes. Storage account, create, and that H again to see what I'm doing. And I get a whole lot of options here because a storage account has a lot more options than, say, a resource group. So in this case, I just wanted a simple storage account. So let's look all the way down and we get examples again. Great. So let's use one of the examples to create our storage account. So first the name, like the resource group. The bad thing is I do not know what I typed just before. So I'm going to take a guess that this resource group and this storage account name is available. And it needs to have the resource group, which was example 2. And it needs the location again, which is West Europe. And there in the example, it says dash dash SKU. Which can be standard LRS again. So let's see how that works. And this is a nice point to mention that I do not work with the Azure CLI that much. I have that Windows background, so I work a lot with PowerShell. I don't use this that much. So this shows to me, but hopefully also to you, how you can get into it by using that categories and just figuring it out while you are going. I do recommend getting into the theory behind it with PowerShell as well, with ARM templates, which we'll get into later as well, and with Azure CLI as well. Do get into the theory and see what you are actually doing. But I think playing around is a great way to get in touch with what you're actually doing, to have some fun with it. So apparently I've created that storage account. So let's see. And I have example 2 here. And it's already there. So that storage account has been created. So that is the AZ CLI. Like I said, you can use them both, whatever fits your needs best. The AZ CLI is very popular because you can see the commandlets are pretty short. So you can create something pretty quickly. Now, there's one thing, a cool thing where they all come together, and that is the Cloud Shell. And if you're talking about making a portal work for you, I need to mention the Cloud Shell. The Cloud Shell is also always available in the portal. And you can reach it here. If you see the button with Cloud Shell there, I can click that button. And it will open a shell right here for me in the browser. You do need to have permissions to create a storage account within your subscription because it creates a storage account for you. And here I can do everything I just talked about. This is a PowerShell interface, and I can also use a Bash interface. Whatever I'm used to and works better for me. Like I said, I always work with PowerShell. They both run on Linux in the background, and this is PowerShell 7, so it's the newest version. And here I can do those things. And this will give some different results, probably. No, it doesn't, because I thought it was in a different subscription. No, it's the same. Oh, it gives my other subscriptions as well. But these give some results on what resources are available. And I did not have to sign in because I already am signed in. I can use AZ here as well, and a bit faster than on my own computer, I must say. So I have that AZ module available. I have the AZ module for PowerShell available. A lot of other different modules are available, like the Azure AD one, so I can manage Azure AD from here. And that connection is all taken care of because I'm already signed in the portal. Next to that, I have some other options available. I can use Terraform, for instance. I can use Puppet here. Another fun one, I can use Git here. So I can clone a Git repository to here and use the scripts that are in that Git repository. Because I just have a folder here that I'm using. This is the folder that I'm working with, and I can go through all these folders. I can drag this to the whole screen if I want. I have no idea how to make this thing go away. Anyway, I can drag it to the whole screen. I can also open a dedicated Cloud Shell, which is shell.portal.com. And what I can do actually is take code. And here I have a place where I can create a script. So like a small version of Visual Studio Code. So I can create a script here. Of course, the Hello World script, and I can save that, and I am at example 4 now, I think. Save this as a PowerShell file. Close that editor. And here I have example 4, so I can use scripts in here. So this can be very handy for quick management. I do not need to log in or look at service accounts or how I'm going to use it. I can do it all right within the portal in the web interface. So if I'm on a Kios computer, I'm not sure if I should log on to Azure on a Kios computer, but who knows what happens, life happens, and you need to do something quickly, you can right there in the browser and with a lot of options available there. And if you make use of that, you might end up with something like this. This is the Cloud Shell, so PowerShell running on an iPad. And yes, I bought a crappy little keyboard, Bluetooth keyboard, specifically to do this. And no, I have never done it again after I took this photo. It was, it's nice that it's, I have no idea what the use case is, but it's nice that it's possible. And with the keyboard, I had Tab Complete and everything. I was on holiday, I was bored. It's nice that you can do it. So let's move on to ARM templates, which are a declarative way of infrastructure as code. ARM templates are maintained and built by Microsoft themselves and by the Azure teams. And like I said before, this is where you can describe what you're gonna want to be created. So you do not need to worry about how it gets there. You just need to tell it what you want to get there. The JSON structure follows a base schema. And this is the schema it uses. And you see that the schema and content version is there, but the most important parts are the parameters, variables, resources, and outputs. Of those, the resources are the ones where you specify what resources you want to deploy. So the resources are necessary to fill in. The parameters and variables you can use to make your templates more flexible. So, for example, the name of a resource could be in a parameter. So you can use the same template for different resources. Otherwise, there's not that much to gain at one point. So let's look at an example real quickly. And this is this one. And to no one's surprise, this example is a storage account. And if we move back here to resources, I can find here that one thing to mention here is that that category is here again. Microsoft.storage is how I define where the storage account is. So this is also where those categories can help you to keep track of what resource you're actually working with. You always define an API version and the name of the storage account, which the name of storage account is what we did in PowerShell and AZCLI. We defined the location like previously and the SKU like previously. As you can see, this one makes use of parameters and variables. And in this case, the parameters are that storage account type. And it uses a prefix for the name. And with the variables, it creates a unique string for behind that name. So you do not need to worry whether your storage account name is unique or not. There are different ways to deploy this. You can deploy this through the portal, through PowerShell to AZCLI, through the Cloud Shell, or through Azure DevOps, through GitHub Actions. A lot of the options available there. And really, it's pick your favorite. And for here, I'm going to use PowerShell real quickly. First, I need to create a resource group to deploy it to. It's always based on the resource group, an ARM template. And let's say example, was it tree it was? And the location was West Europe. And then I would create a commandlet called Azure Resource Group Deployment. That would help me to deploy this template to Azure. And the name is not actually important. It's not mandatory, but I do need the resource group name. So I'll use example tree, like I just used. And then I can define the template file. I do realize this is a bit small and hard to read. But I will make all this code available at the end so you can read it through. And now I can point at that file that I have stored here. And I can actually set the parameters here. I can also set them in a different file or in an object, but I can do it directly. And I only need to do one, so I'm going to do that. And I can use a short one because it will create a unique name by itself. So that kind of flexibility is pretty nice to use. And with ARM deployments, it's important to know that you have an incremental deployment or a complete deployment. With an incremental deployment, it will just look at the resources that are defined. So if the resources are already in the resource group and they are not in your template, they will be ignored. And if they are in your template and they're also already there, then the properties might be changed. When you run a complete deployment, it will clear out that resource group and put it all in there, basically. So everything that's not in your template but is in your resource group will be deleted. The default value is always incremental, so that keeps you a little bit safe. But it's the thing with infrastructure as code that you do take some risks, and that's why it's good to keep track of what's happening in the portal. Now this is ready. So if I go to the portal here, and I'll close that Cloud Shell for a second, and close this one. I now have example tree and a storage account name. And as you see, it created it yourself, its own name with that variable. So we have that ARM template, and I make it all look so easy. But how do you know what to fill in here? How do you know what schema you have to use? How do you know how it all fits together? There is complete documentation on every resource that is available on every schema and every formatting and how it all works. There's complete documentation available from Microsoft. And I encourage you to use the documentation and get a real good feel of what you are actually doing. But with this talk, I wanted to focus on how the portal can help you. And the portal can help you with examples. And I love working with examples. It's gone. Great. And one thing that can help you is the quick start templates that are available in GitHub. And if you see, there are a lot of examples available here. All right, this is taking too long. Do it like this. There's a lot of examples available here. There's a storage account available as well. And I think I found it like this. Storage account create. So this is one way to get an overview of how you can deploy specific resources. This is almost always through the best practices, and it's open source, so a lot of people work on it. So this can be a great resource. But now I want to consider, all we have done till now was create very basic storage accounts. But let's say I have been working in the portal and I have this storage account and I have been playing around with these settings. So I have a cool access tier, and I'm going to disable and enable some random stuff. I have no clue what I have just enabled, and save that. Let's say I have this storage account, and now my assignment is to look for to create an ARM template for this storage account. I can look for an example or look through the official documentation on that. That's very possible and will absolutely work. But there's one neat little trick in the portal, and that is export template. And this is in the left menu for every resource within Azure. And if I click export template here, here I get an overview of what I would need to use to export this template. I can just copy paste this, which I will do for a little bit of readability. And here are those extra options. For example, here you see, this is how you would define the access tier. Now, these templates that are created when you use export template, they are generated and they are by far not production ready. They need some work. Like you see this, I would not use this as the name of the parameter because it doesn't make any sense. This is what happens when you let it be generated. But what you can do is pick out the stuff that you need. Maybe I need it specifically to support HTTPH traffic only. Well, I know I can use this, set it to true, and copy and paste it to my own template. And like I said, that access tier, which I set here, I can put it to a hub tier and or a cool tier and use it in my own template. So this can really help you out when you're creating your own templates and make it all work for you. And this is just one storage account, but with the option to export a template, there is actually a pretty cool option. If I go to that resource group where I had a virtual machine with everything that you need to run that virtual machine, with a resource group, I have export template here as well. So I can put export template here. And I actually get all the resources. I will copy and paste them one more time because it's a bit more readable. But here I get first the public IP address, then the virtual network, like that, the virtual machine. All those resources that are combined with each other, I get them in one template and get to work with them. And if that's not enough, if I have this resource group and I think, well, I only need the public IP address and the network interface, I even have export to template here. So if I do this, it will only deploy those two resources. So this is pretty neat. And this can really help you out with some stuff with your thinking, how do I define that and how do I find what that quickly? And one of my favorite things to where I always use this for is for a virtual machine to find out what reference I need for the image. I have a virtual machine here that's running Ubuntu. And if I use export template here, and I go down here, I find the image reference. This thing can be different for every virtual machine with every image that you can use. So you can find what how it is actually defined, or you can find the virtual machine that you already have and copy paste it. So I could copy paste this in an existing template and boom, now I have a different image reference. The downside from this is that I have to create these resources. I have to have them available already. Maybe they are very expensive resources or very specific resources. That's not very handy. So there's one other trick that the portal has for you. Let's go back to our favorite resource, the storage account, and I click add to create a new storage account. And I put this in an existing resource group because it's not really important. And here I can set that name again. And let's say I want here this in a different setting and I want it cool and networking is fine. And I'm going to enable Blobsoft delete. You see, I'm basically just changing some stuff. So it's a bit more interesting to look at. And if I click review and create, back here, I get a button that says download a template for automation. And I'm not sure how it works, but these are a lot better than the one that you can use for export templates. As you see, this is pretty nice and clean. This is pretty close to production ready. If I look at this, the only thing I'm thinking about is, do I need this much flexibility? Because there are a lot of parameters there. Is it for my use case? Maybe it's worth it to hard code some of these things. But that completely depends on what works for you. But these are pretty clean templates and pretty useful to start with and create your own templates. So this is how the portal can help you with ARM templates. There's one thing that I do want to show real quickly because there's not a lot of time left because I think it's so cool. And that is the Visual Studio Code extension for ARM templates. You can just download this. All these toolings are free. And let's say you're starting with an empty template here and you do not have the option to copy paste it from somewhere. And you're thinking, how did I structure that JSON again? If you have that extension and I say ARM storage, you see I press tab. it sets it all up for me. So all those basic things that we're thinking about are already here, and I can start working on them. So it does this with almost every resource within Azure. So pretty nicely, this can help you when you're starting to create your own templates. And if this is too much, if you think, well, I wanted to do something myself, it also has autocomplete functions for typing your own resource. So it starts with type. And here you see I get every resource that I can think of. And let's say I would want to create a virtual machine. It suggests I use an API version. Much. And it even gives me what API versions are available. If you have multiple choice, always take the newest. Always have the newest API version. After that, I can see name, location, properties, and I can even get all the things that are specific for a virtual machine. So this can really help you out when you're creating ARM templates, working with that, and getting more used to that interface. All right, there are some sources that I want to show you. At the top is my GitHub repository where all the scripts and this PowerShell presentation are available for you, so can use them yourself. That is HAA_ make the portal work for you. Also, I have put here the GitHub repositories for Azure PowerShell and Azure CLI. And the documentation on the REST API, which we didn't use now, but everything that you cannot do with PowerShell or AZCLI, you can do with the REST API. At the bottom is the link for the ARM template extension. I must say, with all these things, these are a bit of shortcuts that can help you get started and get a feeling of the resource that you are using. I, of course, recommend if you start using this in production and being seriously with this, read the official documentation and really invest some time to start working with it. But I believe that if you do this in a dev environment, never in production, and just play around with it, see what happens, it can help you see the fun in what you're doing. And the export templates, I've been working with ARM templates for about 2 years now, I think, and I still use export templates from the portal. So no shame in that. And that is it for me. So here is that GitHub repository again. And my Twitter handle and my blog. If you have any questions later, you can always reach out on my Twitter.
Great, Barbara. Great session. Very comprehensive overview of all the tools that you can use inside of Azure. There were a couple of questions for you. One was, is it possible to set default values for location, for example? So the location is defaulted to a certain region like West Europe.
Well, you can have a bit of a trick for that in an ARM template. In an ARM template, you can just say for every resource that it needs to use the location of the resource group.
Okay.
So with that, you can say every resource that's in there, just take it from the resource group. And I do think it's always a good idea to have all the resources in a resource group in the same location. With PowerShell and AZCLI, it's not possible as far as I know of.
Okay, didn't know that. Another question, can you use Cloud Shell from your desktop or your laptop directly?
You actually can. And my screen is not showing anymore, is it? No. Where I did all my demos, you could see I was using Windows Terminal, which is a preview extension. Oh, there we go. This is Windows Terminal. You can download it now from the Windows Store, I think. And here you have the option to use different kind of shells in one program. And you can actually use the Cloud Shell here. But I will admit I have not used it that much. So I have put it in once And you see it's a lot like you would use the Cloud Shell in the web browser. And now I have the Cloud Shell. So here I see the example that I just created. So it is possible to use it from your desktop.
Yeah, awesome tool, Windows Terminal.
Yeah.
And you can make all sort of customizations, profiles and that sort of thing. Yeah. Really cool.
Yeah, I should put more time into it.
Yeah.
I even saw like Scott Hanselman playing a YouTube video in Windows Terminal.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing.
Yes, Scott has very incredible good YouTube videos on how you can make adjustments to terminal and so, yeah.
Was thinking waste time, how to waste time.
Yeah. One more question. Someone posted in the chat that AZ, the CLI module, is more intuitive than the AZ module for PowerShell, sorry. And you said you are using PowerShell more because you're more of a Windows person. Mm-hmm. What are customers doing, mostly?
The customers that I see are mostly into PowerShell. But there are a lot of them are the Windows developers, the ones that come from a Windows environment. Then they'll often first go to PowerShell. I really see that extension. If you work with Windows a lot, you will often prefer PowerShell. If you work with Linux a lot, you will often prefer the AZ CLI.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks. You have a question?
I think they both have their charms.
Yes. Yes, you're right. Yeah.
Yeah, true. Hey, Barbara, I have a question. And, I really advise everyone to follow you on Twitter. I do. And I noticed a while ago that you became MVP recently. So can you tell me a bit about being an MVP? Because a lot of people who are watching are maybe not that familiar.
I became an MVP in 1st of March. I became an MVP, which was ironic because I was speaking at the Scottish Summit at the 29th of February. So I was on holiday and I get the big email that you get when you become an MVP and you become part of the Microsoft family. People who are MVP are people who have put effort into the community and into showing Microsoft products to the community. For me, I'm speaking at conferences and I have that blog that I keep pretty up to date.
Yeah.
And it's sort of an acknowledgement from Microsoft, says you have done a lot of work and they can give you some help by putting you in contact with other MVPs, which can help give you inspiration and more information.
So that's a bit of the road to becoming an MVP, is just sharing back to the community and, you know, speaking, for instance, but also writing articles.
Yeah, you need to find what works for you and find out what doesn't cost you energy. Say it like that. It should give you energy because I do a lot of work outside of my regular full-time job on writing blog posts, on creating code, on creating talks, and I can do that because I love to do it. And I love all the contacts that I get and all the different people I get to meet in the community. So start working with that, and if you really love what you're doing, it will find its way to you.
Okay, yeah, that's what a lot of people probably don't see, is how much work goes into all the happy pictures and speaking engagements, I think. Hey, and I noticed one thing, and probably we'll run over time a little bit, but I wanted to give you like 30 seconds to promote something. I noticed a new meetup in the Netherlands.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, we are starting a new user group. It's called DDoC, which is for Dutch DevOps and GitHub community. I started that with Jaap Brasser. We are also both working on the Dutch PowerShell user group. And we felt like, well, we want to do something new and see what GitHub has to offer, because I have been following the chat today and I saw a lot of questions. When Azure DevOps was mentioned, people ask how about GitHub Actions, stuff like that. There are a lot of different new options available, and we think that deserves a user group. So we have our first meetup at August 13th, Thursday, August the 13th. And if you want to register and be there, it's all virtual and it's all in English, so it's also for international people. You can go to ddoc.nl and find all the information there.
Cool, thank you very much. So ddoc.nl, a new exciting meetup. I know one little happy octocat sitting next to me here on the couch. Say hi.
Hi.
So we're gonna go to a short break. Thank you, Barbara, for sharing all this amazing stuff.
I hope it
inspires people to learn more about these topics, and of course install a Windows terminal, which is pretty awesome. After break, we have a next session.
Next we have Shalendra, who's going to talk about Dapper and how you can create your cloud native applications with that.
Oh, sounds interesting.
Very interesting. Stay tuned.
大家好。
Namaste.
Servus.
Hi.
Hi.
Bonjour.
Gracias.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Ryan Stropek from Austria.
日本からこんにちは。私は桑田貴之です。
Ciao, sono Stefano Tempesta, dall'Australia.
Hallo, ik ben Albert Scholz uit Nederland.
Hi, I'm Maarten Goed from the Netherlands.
Hi, ¿cómo está? I'm Ruby Jane Cabagna from the Philippines.
Hola.
Hello.
Hey there.
Hola, soy Sebastián Pérez de Argentina.
Ni hao,
desde España.
我是胡浩，来自中国上海。
Hi, I'm Sarah Lim from Scotland.
Bonjour, I'm Sharon from France.
Hello, I'm Ruth from France.
Travoyas from Inter, Sarah.
Shalom,
I'm
Iran Spiller
from
Israel.
Bonjour, I'm Olivier.
Hi, I'm Gilbert Cuvilliers of Gold Coast, Australia.
For everyone who is upskilling this staycation, we have something very special. The Summer Learner Badger, and you can earn one for joining this event. Scan the QR code, which will appear on your screen, and claim your badger. Azure Heroes is a Microsoft program for recognizing community efforts.
大家好。
Namaste.
Servus.
Hi.
Hi.
Bonjour.
Gracias.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Ryan Stropek from Austria.
日本からこんにちは。私は桑田貴之です。
Ciao, sono Stefano Tempesta, dall'Australia.
Hallo, ik ben Albert Scholz uit Nederland.
Hi, I'm Maarten Goed from the Netherlands.
Hi, ¿cómo está? I'm Ruby Jane Cabagna from the Philippines.
Hola.
Hello.
Hey there.
Hola, soy Sebastián Pérez de Argentina.
Ni hao.
Desde España.
我是胡浩，来自中国上海。
Hi, I'm Sarah Lim from Scotland.
Bonjour, I'm Sharon from France.
Hello, I'm Ruth from France.
Travoyas from Inter, Sarah.
Shalom.
I'm
Iran Spiller.
I'm Shoshana Daniels from the Netherlands.
Bonjour, I'm Olivier.
Hi, I'm Gilbert Cuvilliers of Gold Coast, Australia.